on and get your praise on. You know we got it going on at Third Church. At Third Church. Where the word is broken down for you. It's so easy it'll make you wanna move. At Third Church. At Third Church. At Third Church.
Good morning and happy Sunday, Third Church. My name is David. Thanks for worshiping with us. We're so glad you're joining us this morning. Here's what's happening at Third Presbyterian Church. If you're new to Third Church, we welcome you with open arms and open hearts. Connect with us at thirdchurchstl.org/connect and fill out our online Connect card, and Pastor Portis will follow up with you and answer any questions that you may have about the church. Volunteer for Painting Day with Every Child's Hope. Join Rising in Righteousness on Saturday, November 9th from noon until 4 p.m. They're seeking volunteers to help with a painting project at the Children's Living Facilities. Advance notice is appreciated for an accurate headcount. To find the address, visit thirdchurchstl.org/calendar. And to sign up to volunteer, email risinginrighteousness@gmail.com. Hustle and Show is right around the corner. The event is taking place on Saturday, October 19th, from 9 a.m. until 1 p.m. right here at Third Church. If you've never been a part of it, this is a great chance to showcase your product and or service as a vendor. For more information, please contact Linda Glass or Natasha Barsh. You can also sign up in the foyer of the church. You have the opportunity to fellowship with others while diving deeper into the sermon during our Tuesday and Thursday evening Bible studies. Join us this upcoming week and visit thirdchurchstl.org/Bible studies for the study materials and the Zoom link. We'll see you Tuesday evening. The Freddie Ford Foundation is hosting their Trunk or Treat on Saturday, October 19th at the Fenton We Rock the Spectrum Gym. And Rising in Righteousness is looking for volunteers with vehicles to decorate trunks, hand out small toys, hard candy, or hypoallergenic treats to kids with autism. If you can help, we'd love to have you be a part of this special event. Email risinginrighteousness@gmail.com. Join us for Youth Mental Health First Aid Training on November 16th at 9 a.m. right here at Third Church. This skills-based training is designed to not only help parents, but also help caregivers, teachers, and community members recognize and respond to mental health or substance use challenges in adolescents aged 12 to 18. For more details, visit flourishstl.org or contact Shayla Taylor. Third Church is continuing to help make a difference within our surrounding community, but we need your help to continue to make a difference. Third has several ways for you to give, either online, by check, or through our dedicated giving app. Visit thirdchurchstl.org/give to learn more and to contribute. Don't miss out on the next Truth Be Told Black History class led by Elder Lee Robinson. We'll be learning about the many African ancestors of African Americans. The class will be taking place on Wednesday, October 23rd at 7 p.m. on Zoom. To find the Zoom link, visit thirdchurchstl.org/blackhistory. Thanks again for joining us this morning. We hope that you'll stay connected with us throughout the week by following us on YouTube. If you have any questions about anything you've heard this morning, or you just want to learn more about what Third Church is all about, visit us online at thirdchurchstl.org.
Change.
And good morning, Third Church family. Well, today's lesson covers the entire chapter 17 of 2 Kings, and I encourage you to read and reread the entire chapter in your daily devotional time. The story continues with this love, fall out of love relationship that Israel has with God. And throughout the Old Testament, this back and forth continues. The Lord has told them repeatedly, "My main rule is have no other God before me. Do not worship other gods." But in verse 7 says the Israelites secretly built altars to idol gods and worshiped them, burned incense and worshiped as the nations did whom God had driven out so the Israelites could inhabit the land. So God continued to work with them, sending warnings through prophets to say, "Remember what I told you. My patience with you is running thin. If you don't change your ways, it will be trouble." But chapter 17 records they wouldn't listen because they were as stiff-necked as the past generations. The Bible says they followed worthless idols and they themselves became worthless. Oh, that's a word for us this morning. We are what we worship. We are what we worship. So God rejected all of the people of Israel and allowed them to be invaded and taken captive by the Assyrians. The Assyrians then replaced the Israelites with their people to live in this land that had been promised and purposed for them. But the Assyrians didn't worship the true and living God. So God sent the lions among them and were killing them off because the people didn't know what the Lord required. And the king says, "Have one of the priests who we took captive from Samaria go back and teach them how to worship the God of this land and to do what this God requires." The priest taught them, but instead of abandoning their way of worship for the worship of the true and living God, they then had a smorgasbord of worship, an idol worship buffet, if you would. The worship of the true and living God was one of the menu items when it came to worship, and they appointed all sorts of people to officiate for them as priests. Again, no qualifications, no true calling, just, "I want to be a priest. Okay, go be a priest." The similarities of this time and now seem to be almost identical. One key verse that I want you to think about and remember is 2 Kings 17, verse 41. It says, "Even while these people were worshiping the Lord, they were serving their idols." To this day, their children and grandchildren continue to do as their fathers did. And as we engage what is before us today, I want to use for a subject, God, you're asking too much. God, you're asking too much. Fear has a great deal to do with the worship of God. And we see that these people feared God. Verse 33 says they feared the Lord, yet served other idols. Verse 41 says they feared the Lord, yet served their carved images. But verse 34 says they do not fear the Lord. Well, what is going on here? For proper worship of God, we must understand the context of fear. Jesus taught his disciples whom to fear. Matthew 10 and 28, Jesus made it very clear that we should fear God and no one else. King Solomon, the world's wisest man, gave instructions on fear in relations to God in Ecclesiastes 8 and 12. Solomon says, "It shall be well with them that fear God. For those who don't fear God, it will not be well." So what kind of fear is it that we are to have? The fear of God we are to have is a reverential fear, a fear that motivates us to turn away from sin and serve God faithfully at all times. Our fear of the Lord seems to be dictated by what's going on in our lives. Look at the Samaritans. When things are going well, they have no thought of God. And there are times when we look just like that. The intoxication of prosperity will cause us to erase the Lord from our conscious thought. God is not gone. But my mind is on other things right now. That is not a reverential fear, not a respectful fear of our Creator. They didn't serve or think about God, so God sent lions among them. Now, when they thought of God, it was only to tremble because of fear of the lions. This is a picture for us. Many only think about God when the lions of sickness shows up, the lions of lack of resources to pay bills show up, the lions of unemployment, the lions of failure of some kind. Lions come in all shapes and sizes, but it seems that we only think about God when the lions in our life are present. So if we only turn to God when things go wrong, then our religion relationship with God is no different than that of the Samaritans we read about. God is trying to tell us this morning that He's going to continue to pursue us. He will get our attention. But once that attention is gotten, that we should realize God wants us to draw close to Him through obedience to His will, His way. And when we do this, we come to understand how much He truly loves us. And when we turn and serve God out of that love He has for us, that, church, is reverential fear. Unfortunately, many were introduced to God not out of love, but out of a trembling fear. If you're bad, God is going to strike you down. Let me be clear about something this morning to hopefully clear up how many of us was introduced to God. If God was going to strike you down, you'd be struck down. The only reason you're breathing right now is because God loves you and He wants you to love Him back more than you love the world or anything else. So as we look at these Samaritans, they had only a form of religion. These people had no heart to serve the Lord. Verse 33 says that they feared the Lord and served their own gods. The small service they did render to God had only form, yet no substance. These people appeared to be religious. They appeared to be worshiping. They had a form, but God requires more than just form. We possess both a physical and spiritual nature in which we must worship God both physically and spiritually. Last Sunday, we celebrated Holy Communion, which is both physical and spiritual. Praying, giving, singing, each of these have a form, but to go through the form without having substance, which is the right spiritual attitude, is hypocritical. Matthew 15 and 8 says this, "These people honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are but rules taught by men." This attitude has always existed, but this doesn't mean that it should exist. David says over and over that he would praise God continually as long as he had breath. When people are doing things for us, you can tell if they're just going through the motions, especially our children. And our reaction is to dismiss them from the activity because they have form but no substance. We need to ask ourselves a very serious question this morning. Is our relationship with Christ one of simply going through the motions? Are we just form? Am I here today because I think that God is going to strike me down? Am I here today because of the lions in my life? Am I going through the motions of worship because that's what I've been doing for so many years? Am I here physically, but my heart just isn't in it? If that's all we are, then we are no more pleasing to God than the Samaritans were. And our engaged relationship with Jesus has been demoted to just form. And this is how some marriages look. Let me get up and wash some clothes or cook something. Let me mow the grass or fix something. Oh, it's Mother's Day. Here's some flowers. Here's your tie for Father's Day. You want to go to dinner for our 20th anniversary? Well, yeah, we might as well, because that's what we're supposed to do, right? Form
with no substance leaves us unfulfilled in our personal relationship and in our spiritual relationship with God. I want to circle back around to that scripture we referred to earlier in verse 41, where it says, even while the people were worshiping God, they served other idols. They gave God lip service, but they gave their idol gods true service. How many times have we says, I'm gonna, when it comes to serving God, but never have? I'm gonna join this ministry, but I'm still praying about it. I'm gonna come back to church. I'm gonna. If we say we're gonna do this and gonna do that, but never do it, then our gonna is broken. Too many people are walking around with their gunnas broken. Then we put a Band-Aid on our gunna, and for a minute, it becomes probably gonna. The unfortunate part of this disposition is the fact that we only have pause, or we only have to pray only about things dealing with the Lord, but we never pray or pause about actions we want to take in the world. Do we pray to see if we need to accept a job or accept an invitation on a date? Do we pray for direction on purchases that we make? Well, most of the time, we just do it. But we got to pray about serving the Lord. As it was back then, the same is prevalent today in the lives of many Christians. When we seek to minimally serve God while abandoning ourselves to the world will always win. I want us all to think about how many times we have sacrificed our worship of God for the world, whether it be for work, promotion, school, trips, relationships, you name it. And listen, I know there will be times when we have to do some things, but I'm talking about the pattern, the lifestyle, the heart issue that's going on. We are what we consistently do. We are what we consistently do. And when it comes to something being cut or sacrificed in our lives to make room for something else, it is our worship and service of God that tends to go first. Bills gets tight. The first thing we do is we cut our tithes, if we're tithing at all. But our lifestyle is not cut, because we're still going out to eat, we're taking trips, shopping. We got something on the meat for the cookout. We got something on the fireworks. We even got Christmas gifts. All the pleasures of life continue in the midst of our financial crisis. Our service to the Lord is always in jeopardy. When the world says, I need you for this, it's Bible study that's gone. It's service in the ministry that's gone. It's regular worship service attendance that's gone. But we want God to make us a priority when the lions show up. And when we play games and try to ease our own conscience, we say, well, it's because I'm busy. I got all these things going on in the world. That's the reason I cannot serve God on His terms. But I still pray. You better believe I still pray. And when this is our attitude, my question is, what are we praying for? I bet it's not for the opportunity to serve God more or to be more of a vessel for others to grow. We say, I read my word, but recreational reading of the word of God for information does not promote transformation. The whole premise of making disciples means that it's something that is not done in isolation. It's not a self-study. Iron can't sharpen itself. I need another piece of iron. So if you think you can stay sharp without another piece of iron, that is Satan confusing you. You see, church, when our loyalties are divided, our spiritual growth is suppressed. Divided loyalties make the work of the Holy Spirit impossible in our hearts. He cannot teach. He cannot guide. He cannot bring His assurance to our hearts. He cannot produce faith. He cannot empower us to pray. If the Holy Spirit's work is suppressed in our lives, our growth as a Christian grinds to a halt. We become dead weight spiritually. We lose the joy of our salvation. We become bitter and doubtful and visionless people. We become unstable because we are double-minded, as it says in James 1:8. This is why God insists that we be loyal to Him alone. If not, we can never reach our potential. We can never be what He has created us to be. His plan for us will not be realized in our lives with divided loyalties. We can see in the life of the apostles and the early Christians that our loyalty to God should supersede all other loyalties. They faced constant persecution and death if they chose to remain loyal to God, yet they did. Revelation chapter 3 talks about God cannot stand lukewarm, wishy-washy commitment. The same as we. We don't want someone in our circle if their heart is not in it and with us. If they're just going through the motions of friendship and companionship, we don't want them around, especially close to us. God requires our total commitment to Him. Some will say, well, God, that's just asking too much. And in people's minds, it's like a courtroom where we're making arguments that we think are justified before a judge called our conscience, with God on the other side of the courtroom as the defendant. So here's the court scene. The court is being called to order, the state versus God in the case of God, you're asking way too much. The Honorable My Conscience is presiding. The court is called to order, Your Honor, the state brings evidence against God, the God of your asking too much. I contend today that I have a life that I want to live, and it should be not centered around or consumed totally by this God. I have my own identity, and it is unique. I desire to live as I see fit and do the things that are pleasing to me. I come to this place of worship called the church 2, maybe 4 times a month. I go through the motions of songs. I close my eyes. I bow my head during prayer. I kind of pay attention during the sermons. I give a few dollars for the cause when I have it. And I ask this court, isn't that enough? But no, that's not enough. And I want this harassment. I want this constant attack on me to stop. I want to live how I please, and I need God to cease and desist from any further claim He thinks He has on my time, talent, or treasure. Your Honor, it must stop because I can't take this any longer. So we ask the court's clemency in issuing an immediate injunction against the defendant and his desire for my life. The prosecution rests. How does the defendant God plead in response of this accusation of asking too much? Your Honor, my client pleads guilty as charged. Yes, my client asked for too much. Actually, he wants it all. You see, Your Honor, my client created man for one purpose, to worship Him. Man sinned, therefore compromised his purpose to worship, and God loved His creation so much that He orchestrated a plan of redemption for man so that he would be able to function as he was originally created. Throughout history, my client has made his presence known by calling a people and delivering them. He tried to teach them commitments by making covenants with them, but they still continue to forsake my client and follow other gods. He sent them prophets to speak for him, but they killed the prophets. For a moment, it got so bad that for 400 years, my client said nothing. And in the fullness of time, he looked at his son and said, right now. So my client sent his only son, Jesus, who stepped out of his holiness, stepped out of glory, put on flesh, and showed us how it is possible to follow God and his commandments, complete submission to the Holy Spirit. Jesus showed us the power of God to heal and to deliver. He taught with authority. And for all of that, do you know what their reaction was? It was crucify him. So they jailed him on trumped up charges. They beat him unrecognizable. They shot dice for his clothes, beat a crown of thorns on his head, jabbed him with a spear in the side, drove spikes through his wrists and feet. And Jesus, the Savior sent by God, was put to death. After that, I thought all hope was gone. I thought my client at this point would have just called it quits and says, forget about it and wipe us all out and start over. But this is when it really got good. He took his son off the cross, put him in a tomb, and they went to see the tomb where Jesus was buried, and an angel appeared with an announcement of fear not, and asked the profound question, why are you looking for the living among the dead? He is not here, for he has risen, as he said. Romans 5 and 8 says, but God commanded his love toward us, and yet while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. So it was part of the plan anyway. Jesus says he's going to prepare a place for us, and when he comes back, he will take us there. Your Honor, too much? I think not. My client asked for it all because he gave his all. And if it seems strange to you to give your all to my client, then go ahead and worship the God of the Amorites, your forefathers worship. But as for me and my house, we will give our all and worship the Lord. And furthermore, when you worship those idols of the world, call out to them when the lions show up. When you are sick and can't figure out what's wrong, call up the gods that you have forsaken my client for. Surely they will help you. My client does not understand how the world idols ask for more and more, and they get the more they ask for without hesitation, without flinching, without praying on it. They serve and worship these idols with so much passion. My client says, oh, when will I be the foundation their lives are built on? When will I be the one sacrificed for and not continue to be the one sacrificed? I took my son off the cross, but every time the world asks for more, you put him right back on the cross, sacrificed again so the world can be served and worshiped. My client is sickened by just form and no substance in your worship. Why are you praying before you eat when your heart is not with me? You're not praying at any other times. Why are you buying Christmas gifts to celebrate the birth of a stranger to you? If giving a Christmas gift to someone that you have not specifically spoken to about Christ, then you're out of order. Your honor is out of order. This whole proceeding is out of order. And we are leaving. But no, you can play the game with your conscience all you want. But God has said, eventually, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. Because in the true courtroom of eternity, God is the judge. God has redeemed us from sin, saved us from damnation. He can require whatever he wants, but he will not force it. God can and many times will chastise and discipline the rebellious. The Samaritans only wanted a form of religion, a form of godliness, and nothing more. They wanted to check a box. They had communion. They attended service. They dotted I's and crossed T's of the worship form. These are most of our churches and Christians today. They walk to walk, talk to talk, yet only in form. They are filled with functions and activities, yet no worship. They only have a form and nothing more. We can't be like these who will not listen, who fear God with the wrong fear. We are to have a fear that brings a love for God, a fear that causes a change in our life, a change according to the will of God, a fear that will bring about worship to God, that glorify God and Him alone. This will bring the form that God desires in us. We can have both the love and the form today in Jesus. I want to thank you today for tuning in. We will continue our study next week in 2 Kings with a sermon titled, Revival Starts Now. I pray that you join us as we continue to grow spiritually with our study of the Word of God. Until then, remember, be patient, be kind, be compassionate with everyone you come in contact with this week. Be reminded, God only asks for what He has given, and it is never too much. God bless you and God keep you, and we're going to see you next week.
Go back and do a little bit of old school church. Is that all right? I woke up this morning with my mind and it was stayed on Jesus. Woke up this morning with my mind and it was stayed on the Lord. Woke up this morning with my mind and it was stayed on Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Listen, I am on the battlefield for my Lord. I am on the battlefield for my Lord, fighting for Jesus, and I promise to Him that I'm going to serve.
They were